Hello and howdy everybody, and welcome to part two of our little tier list video. Just to quickly recap you guys, this is how the list is looking so far. We ended at around Ed Wood, so now we're going to pick up with the next film.
James and the Giant Peach. I will admit, Burton doing anything with Roald Dahl is always going to be an interesting combination, because, you know, Roald Dahl does have some creepy imagery, and you can tell that Burton would latch on to that. Burton's involvement with James and the Giant Peach, I would say, is actually very minimal. This is another one of those things where Burton's name was probably put on the film to sell, because Henry Selick and his crew were the one that did majority of the work. James and the Giant Peach does have its flaws, though. I am not a fan of the Randy Newman music. I don't know if Danny would have been able to do anything better, to be honest, but I'm not a fan of the Randy Newman music. Granted, I'm not a fan of Randy Newman. Sidelined, I think the only good thing Randy Newman has ever created was the Friends on the Other Side song from Princess and the Frog. Everything else that he's done, I just think is trash. But in regards to James and the Giant Peach, I like a lot of the imagery in it. I love the stop motion used on the animals. I also love the production design here, you know, like showcasing how bad James's life was before. Is it rather nonsensical when it comes to certain things? Yeah, the whole rhino thing. But then again, the book by Roald Dahl in itself is nonsensical. So I get it. But I think it's okay. It's a B. Mars Attacks! Okay, can I just say how much I love how much recognition this film is finally getting nowadays? I have a feeling that majority of what we're seeing with Mars Attacks today is more so of the cards than it is the movie, but darn it, I'll take what I can get. This is A. This is an A. I will admit, the only thing that's keeping it from being an S, it does kind of slog a little bit in some moments. Burton basically kind of nails how I think a modern day alien invasion would go down. You have all these different classes of humans, you know, from the hippies to the yuppies to the, you know, business capitalists to the presidents to the redneck army type guys, and how they would react to aliens that just want to troll the world. I can see all these scenarios happening, and I understand that, like, people, you know, weren't ready for Mars Attacks. Apparently, you know, like, people didn't like it because, you know, when it came out after Independence Day, and everyone's like, oh, this is the kind of alien movie we like. We like Independence Day, and then Burton's here with his weird little stop motion but not stop motion aliens just derping about, just destroying things because they wanna. Maybe that's why I like Invader Zim. The Martians from Mars Attacks and Invader Zim, I just feel like they'll just be best friends. Or they hate each other. I don't know, but either way, I want to see that. Yeah, so Mars Attacks, it's an A. It's an A. Hell, I might even put it to S when it comes to the finalization of this, but I just love this movie. Sleepy Hollow. So I do have to mention on a personal note, I had a friend back in high school who loved Sleepy Hollow, and, like, we watched it almost every weekend whenever I hung out with her, which, you know, I wasn't too mad. It's a Tim Burton film. Of course I'm going to be happy whenever any of my friends are okay with watching one and I don't have to force them Clockwork Orange style. Cool. But I will admit, it did kind of burn me out a little bit on it. Time has passed and I've been able to watch it again. Aesthetically, this movie is all the good vibe. I do love looking at it. So this is, like, when it comes to design and such, this is peak Burton, I feel. This is, like, a genre that I wish Burton would do more with. I wish he would do more creepy historical type stuff, where that way everyone has an excuse to wear awesome, amazing fitting clothing, whether it be post-colonial, colonial, or whatever. And then the girls wear beautiful dresses designed wonderfully by Colleen Atwood. This is the kind of world I want to live in. Do I want to live in the politics of this world? No, but I just want to live in this world aesthetically. Johnny Depp is amazing in it. I love how quirky he makes Ichabod Crane. I mean, you could have gone the Tom Cruise style and be like ultra action star and shit. But instead, you know, you still kind of get that feeling you get with the old Disney cartoon. It's at a B. Ooh, World of Steamboy. And while we're at it, let's mention Melancholy Death of Oyster Boy. Ah, I love these things. I love these things. Okay, these are like unhinged Burton. It's the Melancholy Death of Oyster Boy book and the World of Stain Boy web series. Yes, Tim Burton actually had a web series back in the day. They're very short episodes. If you want to knock them out, there's 6 of them. They're short. Sometimes the credits are longer than the actual content. But gosh darn it, I love the World of Stain Boy and I love the Melancholy Death of Oyster Boy. I will admit, I probably was too young when I read Oyster Boy. So the whole idea of Oyster Boy's dad killing Oyster Boy just so that way he can get his boner back. Yeah, that kind of went over my head. You see Tim Burton's sketches of these characters and you fall in love. This is like one of like my first time seeing Tim Burton's artwork that wasn't like attached to any other movie, and also just seeing it in its most raw form. It's really cool to watch, to read the book. One thing that's also kind of cool, Burton has actually used a lot of the Stain Boy, Oyster Boy characters in subsequent work. I actually went to the Tim Burton Museum, Las Vegas Museum exhibit at the Neon Museum. And what's really cool was that a lot of the Oyster Boy, Stain Boy characters were peppered throughout the exhibit. So, you know, I got to see the boy with nails in his eyes. I got to see Oyster Boy. And then, you know, you also get to see Stain Boy in that weird little video thing that was at the end. Groove into a killer song. Did any of it make sense to my siblings when they came with me? No, I don't care. I actually have a magnet of Mummy Boy in my locker at work. It has a very tragic caption attached to it, but gosh darn it, I love these characters. Stain Boy and Oyster Boy, S tier. I should preference this before we go into Planet of the Apes. I am not a sci-fi girly. Never got into Star Wars, never got into Star Trek, never got into Stargate. That also means I never really watched the original Planet of the Apes. And I think that's why I don't hate this version of Planet of the Apes like so many other people tend to. I never watched the original. I still have not seen the original one. And I definitely have not seen any of the new ones either. So this is my only introduction, my only showcase of Planet of the Apes. And it's okay. I'm not going to call it a failure because it does have some moments that I actually do like. Obviously, this is a film that probably the only thing that keeps it from being a failure is production art and makeup. Good Lord. The practical effects on this damn movie are beautiful. God damn, the makeup is gorgeous. On this, I like Helena Bonham Carter's performance. Mark Wahlberg's. It's a meh. Abraham Lincoln at all. Big Fish. Oh my God. Movie number two that makes me cry like a little bitch. But that's a more recent development. As I've gotten older and sadly, I've lost more people in my life. Big Fish is like one of those films that like, it makes me cry because I have had Edward Blooms in my life, mostly in my own grandfather. Allow me to be a little bit sentimental here, but, and I love the whole idea of trying to discern what legacy is and what does legacy mean to people. Is legacy really what we actually did? Or is legacy the stories that people tell in our wake? I love that. I actually do find that stuff very compelling. And this is like one of those Tim Burton films that you can put on and it's not that Tim Burton-y. You can watch it with your grandma. You can watch it with your mother. You can watch it with probably your Catholic aunt who's throwing holy water every 2 minutes at you. It's a film that everyone can get into. It's S tier for me. I love this movie. Okay, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Yeah, I haven't seen the original Charlie and or Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. I have read the book. You know, Tim Burton does a really good adaptation of it. Minus the whole, you know, side plot with Christopher Lee as Daddy Wonka. But then again, I do also like that scene with Wonka, with Daddy Dentist Wonka. I get it. It's not in the original book and stuff, but the love, Burton actually does put a little bit of love in that scene in which, you know, Wonka opens up the house and he sees all these newspaper articles on the wall and all of this stuff that his dad, even though his dad may not, you know, agree with his son's life, he still supports and loves the fact that his son did the best that he did. Burton mentioned that he kind of had a similar moment with his parents when he went to go visit his mother once he did see that all of his movies were framed on her walls. And that's one of the things that Burton wanted to bring to the Wonka adaptation. Does it fit with the whole idea of devious kids, you know, trying to get away with breaking rules and how far they can get before they don't get whatever prize they want in life? But I kind of don't care. It's still a fun movie. Does Johnny Depp look weird as all in his outfit? Yeah, but I still like the outfit. Probably gonna cosplay in a couple of years. It's a B. It is not fair to compare Corpse Bride to Nightmare Before Christmas, but gosh darn it, everyone does anyway. In fact, I have a whole conspiracy theory that the only reason why this film was greenlit was because Warner Brothers was jealous of that Disney Nightmare Before Christmas money, and they said, ooh, we want that, which also is probably why we're now seeing a resurgence of Corpse Bride, because it has been growing in popularity with other weird stop-motion horror films for kids. Coraline has been, profiting off of that as well. So Corpse Bride, it's okay. Obviously, the stop-motion is beautiful. Dare to say two of the songs are good, the other two are not. I think the biggest problem with Corpse Bride is that the music and the movie don't fit together well enough to me, and I think that's why I don't like it as much. Well, Nightmare Before Christmas, the music fits in together really well with the plot. Well, Corpse Bride, it doesn't. And I think the problem was they should have made that decision or stuck with that decision on whether or not the music was going to fit in or not. But a lot of the songs are what really bring it down for me. That wedding song is just trash. And I also, and heck, I mean, I know Tears to Shed is a beautiful song in of itself, but I don't like the fact that every time Emily tries to invoke any emotion in the song, she gets interrupted by bugs. Majority of her song, her I Want song, is sung by vermin. And I wish we would have just had it said that way. It's just her singing that song. Bone Jangles, best character. Danny Elfman should just voice every single skeleton going forward. He's just really good at it. It's not as good as Nightmare, though. And I think that's my own personal problem with it. I don't think it's fair for me to compare it to Nightmare, but gosh darn it, it wants me to compare it to Nightmare at every chance it gets. So it's at a B. We're coming up now on the Killers music video for Bones. And you know, while we're at it, we're going to talk about all the music videos. So first off, we have the Killers with the song Bones. I love this song, actually. This is a pretty iconic song from the Killers themselves. A lot of people are saying that this is better than Mr. Brightside. I don't know if it's not. You can tell Tim Burton's influence by Jason and the Argonauts is right on his sleeve here. You gotta love it. The skeletons are clear Argonauts. And you even see footage of Jason and the Argonauts and all its Ray, Harryhausen glory. I like this. This is another one that was actually filmed in Vegas. And if you went to the Tim Burton Lost Vegas exhibit, you actually got to see a little model of the pool that the skeletons were swimming. And I think like music videos actually kind of work really well with Burton because, you know, it's kind of like this weird stream of consciousness. You don't really have to worry about like keeping a narrative. The Linkin Park music video, Powerless. Now, that was one that Tim Burton supposedly executive produced. I don't know how much that means, though, in the music video world. Because here's the thing, like the music video for Powerless is like your generic movie music video type situation where you have like generic footage of band playing and then you intersperse that with footage from movie. You know, so, and then I will admit there are some really cool cuts where you have like a lot of cool action scenes from Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter that added really smoothly into the band playing. So that's cool. But I don't know how big of an involvement Burton had with that. And then finally, with the third music video, you have another killer song, Here With Me. This one is trippy. This one is trippy because you kind of have weird kid stalking Winona Ryder. He falls in love with the wax figure of her, and then he takes the wax figure comes to life, and then he also then has dinner, and then everyone's a candle. It's a trippy music video. It is trippy. Oh my goodness, and I like that. You had to watch it a couple times to try and get it. I mean, and there are some moments where Burton is very much on the nose to the lyrics. So here's how we're gonna do this. The Killers songs, they are an A tier, and then the Linkin Park Powerless, I'm gonna put that in miscellaneous. So we have Sweeney Todd, the Demon Barber of Fleet Street, which is an adaptation of the Stephen Sondheim musical. Sweeney Todd, I think, is like one of the last really good full-length Tim Burton films that we've gotten, at least like in this more modern-ish era. Johnny Depp does an amazing job. Yes, is he the strongest singer for this really hard Sondheim stuff? He ain't. Same with Helena, you know? Alan Rickman is amazing. It's a fun movie, but I also do recommend if you are able to see an adaptation of the musical anywhere close to you, I definitely recommend it. So, Sweeney Todd is S. 9. Oh, 9. Burton was a producer on 9, along with Timur. I cannot pronounce that long Russian name. The original short film is really good. I love how moody and atmospheric and scary the original short film does. I don't know, though, if taking that original short film and elongating it, I don't know if it stuck the landing, is really basically my thing. You have like fetch quest video game type film, but it does have some meandering bits into it. At this moment, I'm putting it as a B. Alice in Wonderland. Oh, no. This is another film where I think the hype got to me before I was able to actually see the film. You know, because you hear about Tim Burton doing an adaptation of Alice in Wonderland, and you think it's going to be like American McGee's Alice in Wonderland. Instead, you get this weird in-between where you can tell that maybe Burton wanted to go a little darker, but Disney was like, no. Positives. I think if you were to mute and just have the movie play with Danny Elfman's soundtrack and no dialogue whatsoever, I think it's actually a pretty decent looking film. It would actually work really well as a silent film with no cringe dialogue. You have this weird shoehorn, you know, chosen one storyline that I don't think works in the whole idea of Alice in Wonderland. But visually, it is a beautiful looking film. Is it CGI vomit? Yeah, but this is somehow CGI vomit. It doesn't look that bad. I love the way the costumes look. I've even cosplayed as the Mad Hatter from this. It is a low meh. It is so close to failure. Unlike the next film we're talking about, Dark Shadows, which is, we're just going to put it up there right now. It's a failure. I am not a fan of Dark Shadows. This is one that I did have hype a little. I did watch some of the original soap opera. Yes, the soap opera had its own corny cheesiness, and I don't know exactly what was going on in regards to production here, because, like, was Burton watching the same soap opera that I was? I think the problem is, like, Burton chose to concentrate on the wrong parts. Because most Dark Shadows fans, we're able to look past how shitty the camera was and how corny some of the dialogue was. And we're able to hone in on the essence of the story of a vampire woken up in semi-modern time trying to piece back together and try and figure out what's going on. And there is some of that in this movie, but it is so bogged down by just so many weird decisions and so many concentrates too much of the fish out of water, where the gothic moodiness is just thrown out the window and it's not there anymore. So yes, so Dark Shadows, that's a failure of a movie. Abraham Lincoln Vampire Hunter. I haven't seen this one in years. It is a very, very, very loose historical rendition of the life of beloved President Abraham Lincoln. You know what? Again, it's been a while since I've seen it, and I don't think I've rewatched it since I saw it in the theater. This is a film that you turn your brain off to. At the risk of sounding shallow, the guy that plays Abraham Lincoln's kind of cute looking. That's really all I got. That's it. it's meh. Frankenweenie. Okay, so now we get to talk a little bit about OG Frankenweenie and new Frankenweenie. Because both have their strengths and their weaknesses. The original live-action Frankenweenie, I think one of the strengths is that, you know, you do take a lot of the Frankenstein influence there, and it's like it wears its heart on its sleeve on there. And so I just remember like how quirky everyone in the movie was, and I like that about the original one. But what I love about the stop motion one is that I love, oh my god, the way Sparky moves, just like his little posies. It hits me. Okay. And I saw this movie in the theater, like roughly around the time that my own dog was starting to, you know, like show signs of aging. And oh God, this it made me cry a little bit, like in the beginning, even though I knew it was going to happen. You know what's going to happen if you watch the original one, but it's like, oh no. It's a love letter to the old way of doing like monster films in Hollywood, and also the way Tim Burton looks at monster films. I will admit though, there are some things that are kind of distracting about the new Frankenweenie. I know the movie is trying so hard to adhere to a 50s aesthetic, but the problem is there are some parts in the dialogue that kind of bring me out of the 50s thing. Also, I am not a big fan of the kaiju scene, you know, the scene where where it kind of goes like a little crazy, and again, like one of the animals becomes kaiju. And while like the supporting cast was really strong with the live action one, I don't think the supporting cast is as strong with the animated one. The weird girl doesn't even have a freaking name. I do like how weirdly dark this film goes, and I wish they would have kept with the weirdly dark like climax, you know, like with Sparky versus the cat. But I do also feel like Sparky versus the cat kind of takes away from any blame that the humans have at fault for viewing Sparky as a monster. And there's some things that get muddled in the transition from live action animation, but the animation is so strong. I think it's good enough to make up for what it's lacking. Big Eyes was a film that basically, like, if it's one thing that you learn from Tim Burton's filmography, especially if you follow it from like announcement of film to opening day of when the film is in the theater, you can tell that like if Burton is very enchanted by a project, by a script, he is willing to try to do whatever he can to make it happen. It may take a while, because the script for Big Eyes, I thought Big Eyes was never going to be made. This is probably one of my favorite films. I actually do have something planned for talking about this film a little bit later in the year. Big Eyes, A. Alice Through the Looking Glass. Meh. But like, meh. I'm not gonna say it's any worse than the original one. Sacha Baron Cohen's fun. That's really all I got. Ooh, Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. Okay, I should let everyone know, I did try to read the book for Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children before I watched the movie. But please note, if you are going to read Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children, actually read Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. Don't just do what I did and listen to the audiobook. And you know what I did? I did the text-to-speak option. So it wasn't even an official audiobook version. It was legit Siri reading to me Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. And no, just don't do that. We're kind of missing out on the main gimmick of Peregrine, and that is the weird-ass pictures. Burton's film, on the other hand, I wish there was more of a one-to-one recreation of the weird ass photos, because you think that's like the main reason why Burton got into this. In fact, I thought this was another one of those ones where like I feel like the hype might have been a bit too high for me. But Burton could have done something very similar to his Oyster Boy stuff, you know, where again, random kids with random ailments dealing with said random ailments, and shenanigans ensue. Add in a little bit of X-Men. But it just ended up being kind of bland in that thing. I actually went and saw the movie with a friend at that time, and my friend almost left the theater, and I would not have blamed them. But once you get to the middle, when you get introduced to the other kids, and then when you get the whole weird Samuel L. Jackson villain aspect, it kind of gets a little off the walls. Especially when you get to like the third act where everything's at that weird little carnival. Is it faithful to the book? Not really. You just go with it though. Peregrine's Home is meh, but it does have some weird interesting elements in the third act, and I'm like, okay, it's not horrible, you know, we're a little bit higher than Alice here. Oh boy, the film that at this moment has severed Burton's ties with Disney. Who knows how long that's actually going to last, because who knows how long Disney and their current regime is going on. Dumbo. Wow, this is one of those where I think the studio had a lot of say in how Burton was going to adapt it. I think the studio just basically had the noose around Burton's neck for this whole thing. Now, I will admit, I'm one of those weird people that I actually thought Dumbo looked really cute. I liked Michael Keaton's performance, and I do think it's kind of funny how we shoehorned in the unreleased direct-to-VHS sequel into Burton's adaptation. But as a whole, this is another meh. Okay, Wednesday, last one. I will admit, so as you've noticed, like with how these rankings are, majority of modern day Tim Burton stuff, it's a lot to be desired. We still have our high points with like Big Eyes and Frankenweenie, yes. But then we also have the Alice films. We have some, I don't even want to call them duds. They just kind of feel like Burton's just in Zoom. He's in like sleep mode when it comes to some of those. How do I feel about Wednesday? Well, I actually give it a B. When you take a look at the first four episodes, Tim Burton only directed the first four episodes and he serves as executive producer for the whole entire shebang. Burton's stuff is pretty solid. It's like a pretty good four episode type narrative here. So many moments during like the second half of the show where I can't help but think I wish Burton was here to direct this. You know, I kind of wish I would have seen like what Burton would have done in the family episode, meeting like, you know, with the rest of the Addams clan and all that such. I wish it would have been done like how Burton would have done the finale. It's probably on par with what he would have done when it comes to him in action scenes though. But still, like, a lot of the iconic moments that you see in the first four episodes, I love. Moments is like Wednesday playing the cello, and it's that Back to Black number. I love that. The whole thing with Pilgrim World. The first season has a lot of problems in regards to it being too Riverdale-ish. From what I've been hearing about what's going on in season two, that's going to be hopefully fixed. It's nice to kind of see him happy on something. And even though this isn't exactly like, you know, god tier Burton stuff, it's pretty good. I mean, again, it's a B. It's starting to be like one of his more iconic pieces of work. And I feel like as the show, hopefully we'll be able to get it to an A with season two, which will be hopefully coming out next year. Last look at the ranking. Ba-ba! Okay, look at that beautiful ranking list. Oh goodness, thank you so much for staying with me on this whole thing. As a whole, I kind of hope I was able to articulate my own opinion, and I do want to stress, all these opinions are mine, and mine alone. You may have a different opinion. Anyway, so again, we are posting this on August 25th, Tim Burton's birthday. Happy birthday, Tim. You have quite the legacy here. It is varied. It is slopey. There are high highs. There are low lows. There are whatever the hell Dark Shadows is. And then there's also the greats, like Edward Scissorhands, Sweeney Todd, and Nightmare Before Christmas. There's a lot to look back here and be happy about. So, what do you think? What is your ranking for Tim Burton films? If you have something similar, voice it down below. Do the obligatory YouTube things, and goodbye, goodbye.